welcome. There are some new faces around, so I'm José Alvarez. I teach here, and I am like a kid in a candy store at this moment. Can you hear me? Do you need the mic?
Okay. Because the reason we're slightly late is we got to debating the articles of IO responsibility even before we got here. So what will be unusual is for my students to hear a defense of them as opposed to a trashing of them, which is what I am wont to do. So for those of you who are new to the school, welcome. And of course, I will do a brief introduction to Professor Nolte. But one of the things I wanted to indicate was that this is sort of a twofer. That is, we're trying to discuss not just the question of whether international organizations and members of international organizations are responsible, but also the role of the International Law Commission. And so I think we'll hopefully get into a more general discussion about what the ILC and its future looks like, the role of progressive development and codification. And obviously, most of you know that the question of responsibility of IOs is a very hot topic. It grows out of a number of fairly recent things, the UN oil for food scandal, the actions of UN peacekeepers, the sexual harassment of UN employees, and all sorts of things that people would want to put into this category, including perhaps the actions of the US and the UK as occupiers of Iraq, whether in some way the UN in recognizing that occupation and extending its recognition to the occupiers is in part indirectly responsible for Abu Ghraib, for example. So you can imagine that for a law professor looking at the articles of IO responsibility, hypotheticals spin out in all sorts of directions for many, many exams to come. And so for me, it's a delight to have one of the leading experts on this subject, as well as the International Law Commission. And let me just say a few words about Professor Nolte. He's been on the International Law Commission now for 5 years, so this is his time to be up for re-election. So that's the excuse that we used, was he's here because they have to come through. But that's what it looks like. That is for re-election. I am told it is not a slam dunk because there are a number of candidates for the Western Alliance seat or whatever it's called. That is I'm really screwing up in all sorts of directions here. But let me just go safely to his resume. That is, he's been a professor of international law at Humboldt in Berlin since April 2008, has been a member of the International Law Commission since 2007. He's been a professor of law at many other places, including University of Munich, University of Göttingen, and visiting professor at Paris 2 and All Souls College in Oxford. He was also a visiting fellow here at New York University School of Law, where he co-taught with Professor Tom Frank. He has published many, many publications. Among them is Peace Through International Law, The Role of the International Law Commission, which was a colloquium on the occasion of the 60th anniversary, which I have actually picked up for the introduction, and some of the things that he may not have realized were controversial in that introduction may come up for questions. But among other things, which is close to my heart, he's written about US hegemony and the foundations of international law. So he's been a critic of how the US, for example, has used international law and institutions. He is now very much involved, as we'll discuss, on one of the study projects in the ILC on treaties across time, specifically the question of subsequent practice as a means of interpretation of treaties. And he's written on that subject, as well as on things farther afield, like intervention by invitation, and sovereignty and as well as the responsibility to protect. That's a very brief introduction to a grand figure in international law, and he's going to speak for a few minutes and knock some of the things out that I won't ask you about once you've addressed the crowd.
Thank you very much, Professor Alvarez, for inviting me to come and speak to you. It's a great honor and privilege for me, not just because your university is a very good university, particularly in international law, but also because it's the university of my mentor and fatherly friend, Professor Thomas Frank, with whom I co-taught almost 20 years ago, just after finishing my doctoral thesis. And I wished he would be here. Now, this place has changed. It has become the lion's den for me, because he is the lion. And I feel a little bit like Daniel.
Oh, I'll be nice.
Thank you. But since I know that Professor Alvarez can be very nice, I thought I'd take the risk. I speak, obviously, as a hybrid. I am a law professor in my first life. But here in New York, I'm also a member of the International Law Commission. And speaking here, I cannot speak officially as I don't represent the commission. And in particular, I cannot speak in the name of somebody who is much more responsible for the articles on the responsibility of international organization, which is Professor Giorgio Gaia from Italy. But I also do not claim that I am completely divorced from my membership on the commission, and in that sense, I will display a certain sense of loyalty to the articles and the commission. Now, the area with respect to which Professor Alvarez has invited me to talk about is, at first sight, rather esoterical and technical subject, but once one talks about specific cases, it becomes very exciting. And you have perhaps heard about the Behrami and Saramati case, which concerned troops or from Norway and from France who did certain things in Kosovo. In one case, arrest a person, in another case, not paying attention to the danger of mines exploding with the result of a child having been killed. And the question came up, who was responsible for the possibly illegal detention of a person and the killing of the child in that context, because the French and the Norwegian soldiers were acting on the basis of an authorization of the Security Council. They were acting within the framework of another international organization, NATO. And so the defense by Norway and France was, it was not us. It was the UN, which was supposed to be responsible. So here we have a situation where a question has been asked. Now, technically, the European Court of Human Rights did not directly address the question of attribution here or there, but it asked the question whether France and Norway had jurisdiction over that situation. But that question of jurisdiction implied to decide the question whether somebody else, the UN, had jurisdiction. And in its judgment, the court invoked the draft articles on responsibility of international organizations when they were still in their early stage. One article according to which acts are attributed to an international organization if they are committed under the effective control of an international organization. And in the Behrami and Sarasmati case, the court generously interpreted this concept, said, well, this is international law, according to what the ILC has preliminarily said. And we interpret effective control as meaning overall control of the situation and ultimate responsibility. And since the French and the Norwegian soldiers would not act in that way in that particular situation, but ultimately deriving their authority from UN, it's the UN which is responsible, and therefore France and Norway have not committed any human rights violations. Now, since this issue was still on the agenda of the Commission, it provoked a discussion within the Commission whether we should accept that reasoning, whether the commentary, which is always part of draft articles, should be rephrased and be modified. Because until then, effective control was supposed to mean what it says. Effective control meaning control in the particular situation of the specific act. Now, of course, it depends on policy considerations whether what is a good rule in that context. But at the same time, of course, pure policy considerations cannot determine the law. Now, this rule on effective control is a rule which is established in the context of state responsibility. And there, it makes a lot of sense. And as a point of departure, I think it is obvious that there should be attribution if there's effective control in this narrow sense. So the real question is, or it is pretty safe to say, that must also be true for international organizations. If they actually have effective control over the specific act, it must be attributed to them. So the real question is the is it appropriate, or are there good reasons to widen the responsibility for international organizations? And there may be good reasons. For example, if that is a common enterprise authorized by the UN, why should the individual be subject to the fortuity, to the chance of having been violated by Norway or by France? Maybe both states have enough money to pay, but there are also states which may not be as prepared to pay. So there should be an equal risk, and so there may be a good policy reason. And the question is that sufficient to postulate it as a legal reason? Well, the Commission discussed it, came to the conclusion, no, it's not sufficient, and stuck to its guns, so to speak. I think that's an expression in English. And after a discussion, the Commission said, well, we think it should be limited, this responsibility. Perhaps some colleagues had in mind, but I don't want to speculate too much about that, that the responsibility of international organizations is more difficult to implement because of the immunities international organizations have. And so it is safer to leave more space for states to be responsible. And I think one can say that this decision by the Commission on second reading has been, or is currently being, because the debates are currently taking place in the Sixth Committee, is not really controversial, that there should be this narrow ground of attribution on if there is effective control in the narrow sense concerning the act, and that one should be careful with respect to accepting the Behrami and Sarasmati reasoning. And there are also signs that the European Court of Human Rights itself is somewhat retreating from its previous position. There have been one very interesting case, which was decided this July on the situation in Iraq, Al-Jedda, which also did not exactly raise the issue of attribution, but indirectly raised this issue of attribution, and where the court said, well, the fact that the Security Council authorized the continuing occupation of Iraq does not give this overall control to the Security Council, which would justify an attribution of these acts to the Security Council. So this is an example, perhaps the most important example, of the issue of responsibility of international organizations. I don't have time, and we should not discuss all different aspects and move to more general matters, and I have promised not to speak for more than 15 minutes. So I perhaps say the following. Professor Alvarez told me that you have talked about the ILC for about an hour. There are 34 members who are being elected by the General Assembly on the basis of regional groups. The name of one of the group is Western European and Others. You can call it Western Alliance, and in that sense, it is a remnant of the time of the Cold War. There's still an Eastern European group, and I find it a bit strange that I am not competing against my Polish colleague, because he is in the Eastern European group and I am in the Western European and Others group. So we have a particularly relaxed relationship now. The mandate of the International Law Committee. So these are people who are elected, and there is no particular requirement of qualification other than there must be some moral integrity and things like that. But there is no requirement of independence. And the role is not like that of a judge. So although there is simply no provision which says you shall be independent, there's an assumption that members of the commission take their decision independently, mm-hmm. but there's no strict rule on that.
So no provision saying you can't take instructions from your government or anything like that?
To my knowledge, there is no specific such... there is, of course, a strong understanding in the Commission that one should not take instructions. On the other hand, there are certainly members who have... immediate connections with their governments. Some of them are even legal advisors of their respective foreign ministries. There are professors who sit in advisory bodies for the government, and I must confess I'm one of them. So I'm sitting on an advisory body on public international law for the German government. Now, the question is that something which should be hidden or is illegitimate? Well, that depends on what is the function of the commission. And the function of the commission is not to act like a court. The function of the commission is to progressively develop and codify international law. That's the formula. Traditionally, that was understood to mean to draft treaties. Now, if you want to draft treaties which have a high probability or chance to be ratified by states, you may want to have people who have a certain sense of what is acceptable to states. But on the other hand, if you only have people who are in a direct relationship with states and understand themselves as representing the immediate political interests of states, you could call a state conference in the first place. So the commission is a hybrid body. And that's the purpose. And I think one should not criticize it for being a hybrid body. The original idea is to elect people who, by virtue of their qualification, have a loyalty to international law, have a particular qualification in international law, but who also have a sense of what, for what the international situation is ripe, what for what there exists a receptiveness. Now we can discuss that in more detail, but perhaps I should just say that at the outset. Now, how do such draft articles come about? It is a very elaborate and time-consuming procedure. It's extremely long. But procedures are legitimizing factors in themselves. And the project on responsibility of international organization took 10 years, which is not the longest period a project needed. In fact, it was one of the shorter projects. The articles on state responsibility took 50 years to mature. Now, that was not because the issue was much more difficult technically, but because the political situation was such that some things didn't move forward. A fresh approach was required in the 60s. And so the Commission, if it wants to draft articles in the area of general international law, and responsibility is a classic area of general international law, it must take the political context into account. Concerning the style of the draft articles, the responsibility of international organization articles are very similar to the articles on state responsibility for reasons which we can discuss. The commentaries are more laconic, more apodictic, which may have to do with two reasons. One reason being that there is less practice on which they can be based than in the case of state responsibility. But I would also suspect with the style of the special rapporteur, Professor Geyer, who is somebody who likes the sharp and short formulation and is not so verbose. And I think for lawyers that's a quality, but it may not be sufficient for some taste or for certain situation before a court. Sometimes you want more. But on the other hand, there's a dilemma. If it is not based on so much practice, you cannot just invent too much. You have to stick to what is comparatively clearly to be established. Now, perhaps I should, before I stop, I should say the following concerning the procedure. The procedure is usually that when a topic is adopted on the agenda, that a special rapporteur is appointed. Special rapporteur is a qualified colleague who is expected to draft reports and to divide up the topic so that it can be digested by the members, and that you can at the same time have a global picture, but discuss articles by articles so that you can get a full product. These reports are being discussed in sort of two formats. One format being, let me call it the morning format. It's the plenary meeting when, after a report has been submitted, members make statements which you can read say that they agree or disagree in this point or that point. And this plenary discussion has the function of giving the Commission and the members of the commission a first sense of whether a draft article is generally acceptable or not. But that is still inconclusive. And what you then do is refer articles which are more or less acceptable, at least, to working groups in the afternoon, where those members who are interested, and they are not always all, mostly less, draft, refine this, the draft articles, and discuss on what should be the content of the commentaries. Because you must always read the articles in light of the commentaries. Now, this is a very continental European style, which makes common law lawyers sometimes a bit uneasy. So there may be an intercultural issue here. I think that that's the codification approach, that it does make sense if it is done with care and not too with a too comprehensive and imposing attitude. But one would have we could discuss that. Now, all this takes a lot of time, and after a while, the commission arrives at draft articles with commentaries. After each year, the progress is reported to the General Assembly. So the Sixth Committee, the Legal Committee of the General Assembly, discusses it. Here again, states make their comments without there being a common opinion, but it gives us feedback and gives the further direction to the work. But after a while, a first draft is, a first reading is completed, and the whole articles are submitted again, or in whole, to the General Assembly. So comments on every aspect can be made, and in the light of these comments, a second reading is being conducted, and the adoption of the second reading. And the status of the articles on state responsibility now is we have adopted the articles on second reading. So now, this week and next week, they are being received by and discussed by the General Assembly. And my guess is, and that is the proposal of the Commission, that they will be taken note of and with a view of a possible further elaboration of a draft convention, which sounds like, or to attentive ears may sound like a polite burial, but it is the same formula or a similar formula as with respect to the articles on state responsibility, which have also been taken note of by the General Assembly and been given some form of approval thereby. So they have been handed over to the world, and the world is applying them. And they have
and
been.
And the minute that happens, it changes from draft to articles, or has it already been changed?
Well,
technically, are we supposed to call them the draft articles anymore?
That's interesting. Even with respect to the articles on state responsibility, you sometimes find them called draft articles. I don't know why that is the case. Then they are not draft articles, because once they are out of the reach of the Commission, they are not draft articles. They may be draft convention at one point, but they cannot be draft articles anymore. So please, as of next week, please call them articles. So so perhaps that's a general introduction from my
own. Sure. Now, would you prefer
sure.
that we sit?
Sure, I have to keep this to keep my ammunition if,
okay.
if no, necessary.
So I guess you raised this a little bit. So I guess one starting point is why the exercise at all? That is, international organizations, unlike states, come in all shapes and sizes, have all sorts of different connections to the states. Some are regarded as agents of states, others are not, others are trustees for funds. You have everything from the World Bank, which are it's a bank, to the International Criminal Court, which is a court. And I guess the mind boggles at the idea that you would have common secondary rules
with respect to responsibilities to entities that, unlike states, are not sovereign equals and do not have a common definition as to their powers. So justify for this common lawyer who has some trouble understanding how you can have one set of rules for entities that, incidentally, I don't think have that big a group of primary rules. That is, unlike states that are subject to, say, all of human rights and all of the treaties they ratify, IOs are subject to the treaties that they ratify, and perhaps that there are some fundamental rules that apply to them, but the category of primary rules that apply to IOs is a controversial one. And here we're building secondary rules before we have the primary rules. So the whole exercise puzzles me. Explain it to me.
Well, I think that's a very, that's sounds like a simple question, but it's a question with a lot of dimensions. Now, I think one has to dispel one common misunderstanding. The claim of the Articles on the Responsibility of International Organizations is not to stratify all rules of international organizations. The rules are based on the assumption that there are primary rules, and the primary rules for international organizations are their constituent treaties. And the articles contain an article, I think it's 63 or 64, which speaks of lex specialis. Lex specialis also being the primary rules of the organizations themselves. And here I think a very important distinction comes in. There are the relationship between the organization and its members and the relationship between the organization and its non-members. Now, with regard to the non-members, I think the fact that international organizations are very different is much less relevant, because for a non-member, international organizations are aggregations of different states who act. And it is already justifiable why this aggregation of different states should have a separate personality. But interestingly, very mostly, these states which may be affected by the activity, the non-members, by the activity of an organization, have recognized the international legal personality of organizations. Now, I remember from our discussions in the commission one case which impressed me as an example of responsibility of international organizations vis-a-vis non-members. That is when our Chinese colleague invoked the case of the bombing of the Chinese embassy during the Kosovo intervention. He said, responsibility of NATO. Not just responsibility of an unknown airplane. You don't know from which NATO country the airplane came, but it was pretty clear that it was from NATO. Now you can say, well, there's been little practice in that so far, so there's no real rule on the responsibility of international organizations, and it's China's problem to find which country bombed its embassy. But is that really fair? I wonder. And I think it's unsatisfactory to just say, well, there's not much practice, therefore there's no law, and so let's move on. There are issues there. And I would like to just remind you that the law on state responsibility, which seems to be so well established, and which, where we always quote the Factory of Hotov case, which you have probably heard of, 1928, the Permanent Court of International Justice. And this seems like a rock in the building of international law. If you actually read the Hotov Factory case, it just says, and let me quote, It is a principle of international law that the breach of an engagement involves an obligation to make reparation in an adequate form. In an adequate form. That's all. They don't quote cases. They don't quote state practice. They just say, this is a general principle. And I think here we are in the presence of a characteristic of the law of responsibility. It is close to general principles, which is not the same as customary international law as traditionally understood. That you say, a rule of customary international law only exists if there is a pattern of practice and states are convinced and there is indications of that. The rules on state responsibility have at least one important aspect of their source is general principles of law. And this principle is a quite an obvious principle. And I think the articles on the responsibility of international organizations also contain a number of pretty obvious principles which which can be justified even if there's not a pattern of cases to which we can point where this has been judicially resolved. So that's part of a...
Right, no, and I understand. And I guess one question that I would have is, to the extent that it matters what states intend, do you think that they intended to be responsible for either the acts of, say, the Security Council when it acts either an act or an omission as members, or that they intended their organizations to be responsible? That is, does it matter whether or not this general principle that you're describing is actually affirmed by the intent of states? Because I'm not so sure that the states that are resisting the Sacramento decision are resisting it because they want the UN to be blamed. They might actually think this is where we don't yet have agreement on what the rules are. And I suspect the same thing would be said of the IMF or the WTO. That is, because we lack the primary rules in this case, unlike with respect to states, when we grant immunity to these organizations, it might be because of a substantive preference for immunity.
Well, I mean, when I think we have to distinguish the situation where we have the veil of ignorance, so to speak, when states would come together in an abstract setting and say, what would be the best rule? And a situation in which somebody comes as a claimant and says, I want to hold you responsible. And there one has to be a bit critical about the position states would take. But, I mean, in the case of Behrami and Sarasate, it was, interestingly, the states who claimed that the international organization was far more responsible than the ILC had dared to say. So in that sense, the ILC was the conservative, with much more to your taste, so to speak, inductive approach. Let's proceed from what is safe, rather than what the states claim.
So, but if we follow that along, let's just say for the moment it was properly decided, the UN is ultimately responsible.
I didn't say that it was properly decided.
Well, no, but if we follow the claim that it might
been,
somebody's responsible. Mm-hmm. Either they are or the UN.
Or both, yes.
Or both, proportionate responsibility. Then the point of for this, especially in a court setting, is to allocate financial liability. Mm-hmm. Now, when you do that with respect to an organization, that invariably means that the folks who contribute to the organization will be ultimately paying for it. So wouldn't it have been really more, at least solve the problem more immediate sense by focusing on those four or five articles that you have with respect to state responsibility for what their organizations do, because they will ultimately have to pay anyway? We do have some mechanisms to make states liable. There are some courts, right? But there are fewer courts, or any, for international organizations to be held accountable. So just in terms of practical consequences, we're going to get the states anyway. Why not just go after the states?
Well, first of all, I would not say that we are getting the states anyway. Cases have happened in which states have let an international organization go bankrupt, and then the creditors were there without any money. So that is a real possibility. And the second point is, courts have a responsibility to see or to try to identify what states actually want. Mm-hmm. And I fully agree with you that we have to determine what states and international organizations want. We cannot disregard that. The problem is that in a case like Behrami and Saramati, nobody had thought about what the partition of responsibility was, and then you would have to try to go back to general principles. Now, it is perhaps too easy to say, well, let's always hold states responsible, because that obviously affects the also the international organization. It is not unaffected by states being held responsible. I mean, it is very plausible that states would, let's say, see a different incentive structure in a meta-legal parlance if they know that they are being held responsible, or if they know that the international organization is responsible. I mean, clearly, states would hesitate to provide peacekeeping troops if they know that they are responsible. And they would perhaps be more willing to provide peacekeeping troops if they know that the collectivity is responsible. Now, of course, courts have a certain responsibility that human beings are, that their claims are being satisfied. But they also have a responsibility to leave the basic relationship between states and international organizations intact. Mm-hmm. And I think that is what the European Court of Human Rights in Behrami and Saramati tried to do, and was urged by member states to do, to think about the implications for the willingness of states to provide peacekeeping troops. And to say, well, it might be much more just if one attributes responsibility to the United Nations, which will then hopefully in the future develop a responsibility regime, which would then spread the risk, so to speak, and not leave it to the fortuitous event.
And I think that's right. I think that's key, right? So they think we don't want to discourage folks from contributing to peacekeepers. And my interpretation, it's very convenient then to leave it with the UN, because they knew that there was precious little chance that the UN would be forced to pay in any court, because there is no place for that to happen.
Well, I think the European Court of, or I hope that the European Court of Human Rights is a bit less cynical than what you have just said.
No, but it's not being cynical. It's saying exactly what I think you've said. Let the UN resolve how this happens. Mm-hmm. Now, in this class, or in the class that we discuss, there are many accountability mechanisms, mm-hmm. many different ones, inspection panels, ombudsmen, checks and balances within the organization, even failures to pay right. for things. Right? And that's the experimentation that I think these organizations rely on. And so my hesitation with this is, it seems to reach out and say, well, we really need to have these rules based on what states do, right? And there's that basic question that I have. Why focus on states as the model for organizations, which even the ICJ told us were not supposed to be compared to states? These were different creatures to begin with.
Well, the question is, what does difference mean, and how far is it relevant? States are obviously very different among themselves. I mean, I have talked, I have my bilaterals now, my so-called bilaterals. I mean, I made representatives of different states, and I had the impression that they were representing quite different characters, so to speak. But like us, we are all human beings, but we are all very different, but we are very convinced that we are equal in our subjecthood. And it's a question of definition. We define ourselves to be equal, although we are quite different in many respects, and that is established in our legal order. Now, with respect to international organizations have something in common, at least as far as they are defined in the articles on the responsibility of international organizations. They are intergovernmental or mainly intergovernmental organizations. So they are a concentration of state functions between different states. So they have a state-like quality within their respective functions. Now, why should this sort of part of a state be treated differently with respect to responsibility? Because if for the same issue area, there would be no international organization. If a state would commit an internationally wrongful act, the state would be responsible. If the state does it with two other states and calls it an international organization, why should different rules apply? I mean, I think there's a need to justify that there should be a different rule which applies. Now, it is of course possible that the two or three or more different states, if they create an international organization, provide for special rules as far as the activities of the organization vis-a-vis their own member states is concerned. Of course they can do that. And
so would you say that the World Bank's inspection panel is therefore lex specialis, and therefore the World Bank, insofar as its relationship to the countries it donates money, which are part of the World Bank's operations, then the inspection panel takes care of the responsibility portion, which, as we know, the inspection panel does not entail damages. It's very different from the regime that's anticipated. So would that be an example of lex specialis to you?
I think there's no easy answer to that question. I think the answer is in part. It would be easier to answer your question if, with respect to a, let's say, international organization like the European Union, which has more or less specific rules with respect to...
That's my point.
Yeah. Now, the interesting issue is there's a different kind of specificity with respect to the inspection panel of the World Bank, because it is quite clear that the rules within the European Union are meant to be exclusive. Mm-hmm. They are a special regime, as we say in international law, and there are no general principles coming from somewhere else which sort of shine into this regime. This may be different, but I must be careful because I'm not an expert in World Bank law. This is probably different with respect to inspection panels. Right. But there may be a residual responsibility, right. But there's certainly a strong case to say, well, there's at least to a large extent, especially a special rule, because states, when they deal with the World Bank, they know that these are the rules of the game, and they have to look out.
Right, which is the whole legitimate expectations portion of this, right?
Yeah.
And so I think that, I mean, my own perspective is a lot of folks that deal with these organizations would be quite surprised when they hear that, for example, all the secondary rules that you're pronouncing might apply as residual basis, given what they've been dealing with, because many of these organizations, if it's not an inspection panel, have other mechanisms,
right.
Rarely to include financial damages in a court of law for whatever the organization does, right? Yes. So that gets at what the meaning of lex specialis might mean in the articles. But there's also, to my mind, not consistent treatment of what the rules of the organization are. Mm-hmm. In some cases, the rules of the organization are given very elevated status and will get you out of attribution or other or aspects. But in other cases, there's no mention of the rules of the organization, and we have to guess whether they should be treated like a state's internal law, which therefore won't get you out of international law. Mm-hmm. So,
give me an example.
There are a number of cases in the articles where the rules of the organization are simply not mentioned at all. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. And so we have to assume that that could go contrary to it. One puzzlement, for example, is countermeasures. Mm-hmm. What does it mean to say that something is not inconsistent mm-hmm. with the rules of the organization? And that's one of the criteria for countermeasures. That's an odd formulation, right? Is
yes.
it consistent or not inconsistent?
Yes.
It's sort of in between. So what was that all about?
Yes. That's sort of the lawyerly fine-tuning. These formulations are really relevant, whether it's consistent or not inconsistent. Because
So what do they mean?
Well, they mean such formulations imply a decision on sort of a burden of proof or a burden to show, to demonstrate. So in case of doubt, countermeasures are possible or not possible.
Well, just
and it is the question how, if you look at the rules of the organization, how specific must they be in order to suggest that there is a possibility of countermeasures or not.
Right.
Now, we had a big discussion, and you can read it on the internet. Yes, by the way, this year the Commission took a decision, or the Secretariat, I should say, took the decision to provisionally publish the provisional summary records. There's an elaborate system of publication in the United Nations, which has to do with, let's say, different languages, the possibility of people to check what they have said, whether that was accurately translated or accurately received or summarized. Our records, the records of the International Law Commission, which were until publication, they had a 7-year time lag, mm-hmm. which is terrible. And so now the courageous decision has been taken to say, okay, we put the provisional summary records provisionally on the net. They may still be changed if a speaker says, well, you got me wrong here. But at least you get a sort of 95 or 99% chance that this is what was said and that you get an idea of the discussion. So, with respect to the not inconsistent, the big issue behind the debate was, again, the distinction between the relationship between member states and the organization and the relation between non-members and an international organization. And within international organizations, it is more difficult to conceive that there should be a residual possibility of countermeasures. And the formulation not inconsistent was meant to mean there is a high threshold to cross and to demonstrate that such right. such things are possible.
Well, we'll soon turn it over to the audience because we want to have Q&A. But let me just ask one thing that before we came into this session became clearer to me is that some people might defend this exercise as what you would call a sort of what we would call in the U.S. an expressive exercise. That is, we want to send the message to these organizations that they should be held accountable. And unless they prove otherwise, to sort of shift the burden. And so I will grant you that you want to send expressive messages here. And that's one of the problems I have with the countermeasures regime. Because the message that appears to be sent here is that on some occasions, it may be proper for a member to take countermeasures against the organization for what a member regards as something that is unlawful. And so, for example, many, many years we studied it in this class, the U.S. took its position that it doesn't have to pay a portion of its UN dues when the UN was, for example, paying for the Law of the Sea Commission. And that was one occasion when the U.S. sort of made a legal argument about that it was unlawful for the UN to do something that was a treaty regime that the U.S. was not a party to. And so the message that's being sent, which I think is a very detrimental one, is that maybe sometimes you can stop paying your dues as a legitimate countermeasure, and I've gone through your articles, and it seems to fit, and that the same could be said for the organization, that the organization that decides to deny the credentials of Israel or South Africa or others before the General Assembly because it's not inconsistent with its rules, there's no absolute rule barring that, may be able to take that. And I think the expressive message sent when neither the U.S. nor the I.O. in those occasions have actually used the term countermeasures is significant.
Well, I disagree with your assumption that the articles are in a way legitimizing or encouraging the use of countermeasures. I think I would have expected from an American international lawyer to say the contrary.
Oh, but I'm not an ordinary American lawyer. I don't defend American hegemony that well.
Well, and I'm not as critical of American hegemony as people may have understood. I mean, we have to discuss hegemony, and I think the policy of the United States changes sometime from time to time. Now, I've just looked at the article which we are talking about, and I think it's Article 52, and let me just read it. Countermeasures may not be taken by an injured state or an international organization which is a member of a responsible international organization against that organization in response to a breach of an international organization under the rules of the organization, unless such countermeasures are provided for by those rules. Now, that's a formulation which says you may not take countermeasures if you're a member unless there's an authorization under the rules. That's virtually a prohibition, isn't it? So I think the assumption is not correct. And the question is also, what is the alternative? If one would not have addressed the issue of countermeasures at all, would that immediately be understood by everybody as meaning a prohibition of countermeasures? No, of course not. Rather address it and contain it than not to address it at all. That's, I think, the position the Commission has taken.
Well, one last one on just the ILC generally, and that is the progressive development versus codification. So in this case, the Commission is telling us there's a lot of progressive development relative to codification compared to the Articles of State Responsibility. And so I guess, just more generally, the International Law Commission is engaged in doing both. And it has a choice of how to do it. That is, it could recommend to the General Assembly, we really think a treaty is a good idea. And so one possibility that some would say is, well, when you have this level of progressive development, where so many of the commentaries suggest there is no practice, wouldn't a treaty actually be a good idea to recommend to the General Assembly? Because that will be the ultimate political check. You will then be able to see whether these are really rules, because as it is, what could happen is what I think Santiago Villalpando has suggested, the Santa Claus effect. That is, that the rules are routinely cited by tribunals by way of dicta when it doesn't actually affect, as in, say, the cases that you're describing, where nobody is actually held accountable, but they'll bless the articles along the way in a way to suggest law exists when it really doesn't. And isn't a treaty mechanism a more refined way of testing whether this is really a academic or a political exercise, a real politique exercise, which gets at the more general question of how do you choose which way to go? Because it looks to me that in many current exercises, it looks like you've latched on to guidelines, studies, draft articles, instead of the good old-fashioned treaties. And when you come to the good old-fashioned treaties, it turns out that, you know, we went back, this class did, and looked at the treaties, the 26 treaties through 2004. And of the 26, 13 had, after a considerable period of time, not reached 50 members. And they were all intended to be universally applicable treaties. So it looks like when the ILC has tried to do treaties, half the time, it's not done very well. So, but at least in those times, well, the treaties just fall apart because nobody ratifies. But the risk in something like this is, when you don't do it well, how do we have a check?
Okay. Well, you assume that the ILC is this powerful institution which needs to be held in close check, and I wonder whether this corresponds to the self-understanding and the perception of the ILC. Now, I think here again I would first question the assumption. If you share my premise that many of those rules derive from general principles, it's harder law than you would concede if you say, well, this needs to be established by customary state or organizational practice. So the Commission has not said that, oh, this is generally progressive development. Let me just read the sentences which have been included as in a general part this year in order also to respond to criticisms like yours. And you are certainly aware that Professor Alvarez is probably the most prominent critic of the articles. Well, I can assure you that your spirit was present, mm-hmm. and you were quoted in the discussions. now, let me read. The fact that several of the present draft articles are based on limited practice, several of them, moves the border between codification and progressive development in the direction of the latter. It may occur that a provision in the articles on state responsibility could be regarded as representing codification, while the corresponding provision on the responsibility of international organizations is more in the nature of progressive development. In other words, the provisions of the present draft articles do not necessarily yet have the same authority as the corresponding provisions on state responsibility, as was also the case with the articles on state responsibility. Their authority will depend on their upon their reception by those to whom they are addressed. So, it says several articles. I don't think it says this is all progressive development. And
so you personally would not recommend a treaty for this?
Well, I have not yet reached this. I personally think it serves a purpose before it becomes a treaty. It would be, I think, also a good idea to have it as a treaty, but I don't think that having making it a treaty would serve as a political check, because the issue is that cases will come up in different fora, and the human rights fora are fora where these questions are raised in an indirect way, as demonstrated in Behrami and Saramati. And they can also be raised, other draft articles can come up, so that in a connection where the international organization itself is not implicated, but the question of attribution or something else. So regardless of whether these articles exist, courts would have to develop rules, principles. And I think it's more than Santa Claus if these articles are there, and if they still appear plausible in the light of specific cases, and I'm quite confident that they will be a strong Santa Claus, so to speak. Real presence.
They're strong, right?
So now, in a sense, there's an interesting reversal of roles. The common law lawyer would usually say, well, law develops by accretion, case to case, and plausibility in the light of general principles, don't try to codify. Now, this is an inspiration for this process of accretion. And it is not a threat which needs to be checked because it is overbearing, because it pays its respect to the rules of the organization and what states intend. And interestingly, this question of Behrami and Sarmati will continue not only by way of jurisprudence, but also questions will be raised on the political level. That is, will the Security Council explicitly say, well, responsibility under this authorization will lie with member states or with the organization? Member states may have an interest to make the Security Council say, well, for this, the United Nations will assume responsibility. And there may be limitations to enforcing that responsibility. But there may also be a pressure to develop systems within the United Nations, within other organizations, to satisfy the claim in principle that there should be some responsibility or accountability.
So we really promised questions, so I'll let you pick them out, and I'm sure there's some.
Please, Julian. Julian was my intern in Geneva. I hope I don't expose you to anything, but I'm very happy that you are here, and we have had an excellent working relationship, and more than that.
Since you both mentioned it briefly, and since the case study was Behrami, Sarmati, and Al-Jedda, I wanted to ask about multiple attribution, the possibility of a plurality of responsible states or responsible states and IOs. I wanted to ask, in light of what you said about many of these reflecting general principles rather than custom, because something that seemed very difficult with multiple attribution and responsibility in both sets of articles is actually the lack of practice there to deal with. There's much more for states, but it's a difficult thing. And I wonder if you would make the same argument that comes from a general principle, because
multiple attribution,
yes, mm-hmm. and multiple responsibility, because it's not the same kind of thing that you need this for law. And then second to that, since we have it anyway, this is an independent part of the question. What does that do to the incentive structure question?
Absolutely. I mean, that's a very legitimate question, and I agree with you that multiple attribution can be much less easy justified on the basis of general principles, and that's one of the reasons. Well, it is contained multiple attribution, but to a limited extent. For example, there was a discussion about whether there should be a responsibility of international organizations for their recommendations. And assuming that there would be a responsibility of the state for an internationally wrongful act, but if that act was taken on the basis of a recommendation of an international organization, should not also the international organization be liable? And Gaia proposed that, and some members, including myself, did not like the idea because it would very much discourage international organizations to recommend, and it would encourage states to act irresponsibly. But that's a consideration which I cannot base on, well, I can base it on practice by saying, look, nobody has ever claimed that a recommendation should lead to responsibility, so there is some opinio iuris there, indirectly. But that's not a particularly strong point, I must confess. So I agree with you that there's a difficult issue of incentives which would be given, but I mean in a body like the International Law Commission, it is difficult to talk about incentives. Incentives must be pretty clear and discernible in order to be debatable as, let's say, translating into legal rules. Of course, everybody thinks about them in the background, but that's a question of relationship between law and politics, law and reasons for law, which can be more openly discussed in a law school than in a body like the International Law Commission, which does not mean that people are not conscious of it, but once it gets more complicated, it's less easy to translate.
Go ahead.
Please, and then first gentleman in the first row, and then please.
So my question jumps right off that point about recommendations, because I think that that's really interesting, and it highlights the problem of variation between international organizations. So the issue of recommendations is that that's actually a lot of what some international organizations do. It's pretty much all they do, especially when you get down to the specialized organizations. And if we think about this, just, you know, if we make a domestic analogy, we think about, well, what do we do about bad advice, you know? So if I do something that my accountant told me to do that was illegal, and I try to rely on his advice to get out of liability, I can often do that if the advice seemed legit. And what's the check on the accountant? Well, we have concepts such as fiduciary duty and you know, duties of professional responsibility. And all these kinds of, we have a very robust set of primary norms, say, that are different across different professions and that are different, you know, and the liability structure is different for accountants and for lawyers and for,
yes,
you know, et cetera. And so doesn't this kind of bring us back to one of Professor Alvarez's earlier points, which is that isn't a general responsibility regime, does that serve to paper over that question?
Well, I think in that case, the general regime says no liability for recommendations, which means that if states or the international community have the impression that there's a problem with no responsibility, for example, if the WHO, the World Health Organization, would issue warnings and say, well, there's this infectious disease going around, and everybody gets in panic and loses a lot of money. If that would happen in the... you are smiling?
Perfect hypothetical.
Okay.
Keep them coming.
In the national context, there would be state liability. In the international context, there are good reasons not to take that for granted, but to wait for the political process to develop a regime of responsibility. So what the articles on responsibility of international organizations are doing is we are developing a general regime in the area where it is comparatively safe. It is precisely not imposing, making a political choice, imposing a regime where it is not, where there needs to be a political check. I think you would have been right. I mean, you are right, but I would be more easily convinced if a responsibility for recommendations would be included in these in these articles as a residual.
So the answer here would be develop the lex specialis to make them, in those cases, responsible for certain recommendations that are treated as binding.
Absolutely, absolutely. But that's not the job for the International Law Commission.
I had somebody in
there. I think.
You're coming up for re-election at a time when the commission has been criticized in some quarters as having run out of ideas, and that most of the topics that it's adopting are not viable and are unlikely to have much impact on state practice. I wonder whether what you think of that criticism. Some of these topics, such as the effect of treaties, the effect of war on treaties, have been, certainly academic sample, as unlikely to have much impact, and that much of the development in international law are in any case taking place by way of lex specialis, and that the commission's agenda is very different from what it was, say, in the 50s and 60s, where much of the qualifications, say, on the law of the treaties stem directly from the work of the commission.
Mm-hmm.
Related to that, if elected, what topics do you think the commission should adopt for the next 5 years?
Excellent question, which is also being raised in some of my bilateral meetings with representatives of states. Now, you can find my long answer to that in a publication you can download on my... I have a website as a candidate, and I have published a piece on the International Law Commission facing the second decade of the 21st century in the Festschrift for Bruno Zimmer, Essays in Honor of for Bruno Zimmer, who is the German judge on the ICJ. And I try to address this question. I think, to give a sort of indicative first impression answer to that, if that would be true, the elections would probably not be so competitive, and states would not put up candidates, invest a lot of money and resources to have people elected into the International Law Commission, and they are more competitive than they were 5 years ago. That may be an indication that perhaps this view, which was formulated, I think, which came up after the articles on state responsibility were adopted, and where there was a certain fatigue in certain quarters that resulted in sort of general conclusions, which I think are premature. I think the you are quoting, it's difficult to assess the effects of the project, effects of armed conflicts on treaties, and I hope, not very many armed conflicts will happen, although they do. But if you look at the two projects which have just been completed, responsibility of international organizations at reservations to treaties, I have no doubt that these two projects are pretty relevant. The Commission is currently dealing with few other topics whose relevance I think is immediately visible. Protection of persons in the event of disasters raises very general issues of international law, sovereignty, responsibility to protect, human rights. What is the relationship between those general principles? In a sense, issues of humanitarian intervention loom in the background, and if you want to get a feel for the current state of these principles, look at this particular project and the debates which have been conducted within the Commission on these. And there you see, and that's, I think, something which international lawyers should always bear in mind, you get a different impression on what is considered to be relevant and what is considered to be the majority opinion, depending on whether you listen to a representative assembly like the General Assembly or the International Law Commission, or when you read academic commentary. Now, I'm myself an academic, and I take academic commentary very seriously, and I know that academic commentary translates into practice very often. Because practitioners, when they are insecure about how to decide, they do look into books. And then if there is a good idea, if there is a plausible formulation, perhaps they don't always admit it. So I think it's to be taken very seriously. But one also has to see that the origin of the thinking of there's not the same group of thoughts is being represented in one community and the other, or more or less. For example, I'm currently writing a commentary or updating a commentary on Article 51 on self-defense, which is a favorite subject of everybody who does international law. And there's this question of whether an armed attack must be attributed to a state or not. And the ICJ has said in the Wall case, well, it must come from a state, and it was subjected to fierce academic criticism, and you almost have the impression there is unanimity, depending on which language you read, that this is out of this world. If you discuss this issue in the UN, you get a different sense of where the majority lies. And I think we have to take that seriously. A topic like protection of persons in the event of disasters, expulsion of aliens, immunity of state officials from foreign criminal jurisdiction, one of the hottest topics in international law, and it's an opportunity for the International Law Commission to give a sense of direction to national courts.
For your own topic, treaties across time. You haven't said much about that, but I think it's quite relevant.
Well, treaties over time. Here I'm judging my own cause, so perhaps I should not try to advertise this this topic too much. It's a topic which would not have as a ultimate goal a draft convention. It's a question of how treaties, once they have been concluded, develop over time. How are they being reinterpreted? In particular, if there is no judicial institution which constantly interprets and reinterprets the treaty, but it's how far does the practice of states, or under which circumstances does the practice of state is it able to reinterpret and perhaps even to modify treaties? So that's a topic I'm interested in, and it is a topic of general international law. A parallel topic which is just being proposed, I was taken aback when I first saw it, because it's so courageous to try to do it, the topic of formation and evidence of customary international law, a topic which is debated also in the United States under this particular constitutional from this particular constitutional point of view, how legitimate is customary international law, and under which circumstances can it be considered to be legitimate? Does it consist on actual state practice, and what about verbal practice? And it becomes relevant when customary international law is to be applied in court. Now, there is no authoritative statement on the formation and evidence of customary international law. And if it would not have been our British colleague, Sir Michael Wood, who was the legal advisor of the British government and who is one of the really leading international lawyers, I would have said, well, maybe that's a bit courageous to try to do, but I do think that it is a valuable exercise, so that national courts have a comprehensible source to think about customary international law, because otherwise this this source of law risks not to be taken seriously anymore, and that would be an impoverishment for international law, which cannot rely on the development of treaties in every area, particularly not in the relevant and disputed areas.
So if you don't mind, we'll stay a couple more minutes so you can answer a couple more questions, if that's okay with
sure,
you.
Sure, sure. I have more time than you have. Please.
Yes, I was wondering if the possibility to distinguish between the conduct of an organ and or an agent has been raised, particularly if, for example, different provisions could be referred to the possibility that the conduct has been taken by managerial or some kind of figure which exerts decisional power, and in contrast with the possibility that, for example, Blue Helmet or some other agent which has who has only executive duties.
Mm-hmm. Well, the perspective of the Commission is that of conduct of the organization and not the attribution of responsibility to individual agents. So the concept of agent and organ is only important to determine whether the organization has acted, regardless of the level. So we are not in the in the realm of personal responsibility, be it criminal or civil. So it's just the organization. And for that, it doesn't really matter whether it's on a high level or on a lower level. Mostly it's the lower level act, which is the act which is visible. And the decision before is not a decision which sort of is a decision by the organization with outside effects.
But you have adopted a pretty broad definition of organizational agent, right?
Yes, that's right. Absolutely. I don't know it by heart, but it's broad, right?
Sorry, I used to be a corporate lawyer, so I was just trying to draw a parallel with an Italian decree we have since 2001, which introduced responsible liability for corporations, mm-hmm. for white-collar crimes, for
right.
example. And there is a clear distinction in the two cases. For example, my ex-boss was selling a lot of compliance programs to corporations because...
Which kind of programs?
Compliance.
Compliance programs.
Programs. Mm-hmm. So it's kind of internal audits, but a particular surveillance organ can be appointed to oversee the conduct of the employees.
Mm-hmm.
So I was just trying, in that case, the aim is to exempt the corporation from pecuniary sanctions. If the corporation proves, for example, that there are two different regimes for the employees, if the corporation has adopted these compliance programs,
mm-hmm.
and proves that it has been implemented and
mm-hmm.
adopted and everything which was needed to...
If it has done its best efforts, so to speak.
Yeah, so yeah. It doesn't...
It is not responsible.
Right. So
mm-hmm.
If we translate this, for example, to the international organization, we could say that the international organization in that case doesn't have an economic liability, and on the same time, I think we could make a distinction and for managerial positions, because in that case, I don't really see why the organization should be economically liable for a decision which has been taken by governmental representatives, for example. So it could be just...
Well, I think your question relates to issues which would be primary rules and which would be developed. It's a sophisticated form of liability So it is not part of the residual.
But it also raises that line between what is a primary and a secondary rule, right?
Yes,
that,
absolutely.
That has always been difficult for states, and I'm sure it's going to be difficult
yes.
here.
Yes,
and but it does raise the possibility of another topic, which is very hot in the United States. General principles of law applicable to corporate liability would be lovely for the ILC to take up. This is a very hot topic. It's going up to the Supreme Court in the U.S. right now.
Okay, and so I'm not concerned about the future of the ILC anymore after this, that we are running
right,
out of topics.
All right, one more question.
Yes. Yes, please, your question. Which?
Yeah, 58, paragraph 2. So if I understand it correctly, is that saying that a state member, if he conducts some acts in accordance with the rules of that organization, even if that's action or the conduct is wrong, the state has no responsibility?
Ah, let me see.
I don't know if I correctly understand it.
Under this part.
Mm-hmm. So I think that's kind of...
That's an example of how the rules go one
way
and the other way. I think why that states, if he acting accordance with the rules of the organization, the states won't be responsible, but the organization will.
So it's the 58 paragraph 2. State is responsible?
This is on aiding and assisting.
Yes, yes. I think you caught
and
me
this
on this.
Was not part of Article 16 of the Articles of State Responsibility. So this
no,
is
no.
This is where you've departed from the Articles of State Responsibility to put that second paragraph in 58.
I'm sure that the answer is in the commentary, and the explanation is in the commentary. And my suspicion is that this Article 58, paragraph 2, although it does not say so explicitly, is limited to situations within an international organization. So that in that case, the organization is responsible for an internationally wrongful act and not the state which has followed the rules of the organization. Even if the organization would not exist, it would be an aid and assist, aiding and assistance which would lead to responsibility. I think that is what is meant here. Although I concede at first, or rereading, I don't see this limitation which I interpret into it right now. But I'm pretty sure that this would be the answer. And I think that's also a plausible rule. Very good question.
Well, thank you very much for being willing to submit yourself to all of this today, and especially in the midst of an election season. So let us thank our guests.
Thank you very much. You made me remember my time 20 years ago with Tom Frank. You are still pretty active and pretty bright and pretty attentive. And you have been a very civilized lion today. Thank you very much.
Thank you. We'll have dinner in a minute.
Yes.